Hello everyone, I welcome you all in Bio Molecules lecture series. Today we are going to discuss lecture 8. Before going to the main course of today's lecture, I will give a recap to the last lecture. In the last lecture, we talked about the amino acids, and there we discussed about the different type of amino acids based on their structures, where we divided it in amino acids with the aliphatic side chain, amino acid with the acidic side chain, amino acids with the amides of acidic side chain, that amino acids with the basic side chain, then amino acids with the heteroaromatic cores. All these and then amino acids with the aryl side chain, and amino acids with the thiol as a sulfur containing side chain. All these classification we discussed in detail, and then we talked about their acidic and basic properties, amino acids acidic and basic property, and where we learned that generally amino acid has tendency to be in its ionic structure, ionic form, and that is in totality it is basically neutral, but in the scaffold amine tries to be in the ammonium form, whereas the carboxylic group tries to remain in the carboxylate form, and the pH at which the population of these molecule remains in the ionic form is known as the isoelectric point. So there we discussed about the how isoelectric point is important, and we have also talked about the how to calculate the isoelectric point, that if you know the pK of particular functional group in the amino acid, then we can easily evaluate the isoelectric point, which is basically, if you know the 2 pK, there are only 2 functional group in mainly, one is the carboxylic acid and other is the amine at the alpha position. So, if you know the pK of these 2 functional group by adding and then dividing by 2, one can get the isoelectric point at which it tries to remain in the ionic form, where amine remains in the ammonium form and carboxylic acid remains in the carboxylate form. Basically, what happens is that carboxylic acid proton gets transferred on the amine's nitrogen and forms ammonium. We also discussed about how to determine the isoelectric point of the amino acid with the different substituents. Substituents means if it has proton receiving substituents like heteroaromatic cores as a substituent, or some heteroatoms are there. In that case, how we can evaluate? There also basically, if it is a it has like ionizable side chain, then in case of base, we consider that basic group as well as the amine pK, we add and then divide it by 2, whereas if it is like acidic amino acid, then carboxylic acid pK and the acids another substituent acids pK add and divide it by 2. It is a very simple way to determine. We also discussed about protein structure. In the protein structure, we learned that there are 4 types of structures, and in the primary structure protein of the protein, basically we discuss about the sequence of amino acid in the chain, and the location of all the disulfide bridges. Whereas in the secondary structure, where regular conformations assumed by the segment of the protein's backbone when it folds, and it comes in a repetitive manner. In the secondary structure, basically the secondary structures are regular conformations assumed by the segment of proteins backbone when it folds. So that determine the secondary structure. Tertiary structure, you know, is the three-dimensional structure of the entire protein, whereas in the quaternary structure, if the protein has more than one polypeptide chain, then what is the, what way the individual polypeptide chains are arranged in the protein, if it has more than one protein, that determines the quaternary structure. I will start from the, you know, determining the primary structure of polypeptide chain. And how to determine the primary structure of a polypeptide or protein. So, how to determine the primary structure of a polypeptide are a protein. So, one way to determine the structure of a polypeptide that, you know, we can break the disulfide bridges in the polypeptide so that, you know, it can attain a basically a linear structure. So, the important, I mean, transformation for determining the primary structure of polypeptide is breaking the disulfide bridges. Breaking the disulfide bridges. How to do this? How one can attain the, you know, breaking of disulfide bridges? It's very simple. The one way to do is reduce the disulfide bridges. Reduce the disulfide bridges. Bridges in order to obtain a single peptide chain. Reduce the disulfide bridges. In order to obtain a single polypeptide. Polypeptide chain. So, how one can attain this transformation? For that, we will use reducing agent 2-mercaptoethanol, which will break the disulfide bridge by the reaction with the, you know, reducing agent 2-mercaptoethanol. So, here we are going to use a reducing agent that will basically oxidize the disulfide functional group. So, we will achieve this transformation by applying a reducing agent to 2-mercaptoethanol. So, let me write here the molecule with the disulfide bridge. So, this is the representative, you know, structure of a polypeptide with the disulfide bridge. This is the disulfide bridge. And we will react it with two-mercaptoethanol. tumor captoethanol. So after reaction, it will get converted to the corresponding sulfide, will get thiol. It will get sulfide will get reduced to, you know, thiol. So and tumor captoethanol will get converted to, you know, sulfide. Now the possibility that, you know, if these thiols remain as it is, you know, as we know that they have tendency to again get, you know, oxidized and get converted to disulfide. So it will be further reacted with the iodoacetylene. So protein thiol group will be treated with the iodoacetic acid, so that it can convert, it gets converted to the corresponding two molecules of so now after the reaction with iodoacetic acid, this is iodoacetic acid, this thiol group, you know, prevents from the again disulfide bridges as a result of oxidation. Now again it can go for oxidation and form the, you know, disulfide bridges, but once you treat this protein thiol group with the iodoacetic acid, sulfur basically oxidation gets, you know, stopped and it gets converted to the corresponding derivative. So now it's not available for again going back to the, and that way you can get the, you know, polypeptide chain without the disulfide bridges. Now this can also indicate that, you know, how many disulfide bridges are there by the number of this, you know, I mean substituent one can determine. Now let's talk about the determining the number and kinds of amino acids. The number and kinds of amino acids. To determine the number and kinds of amino acids, number and kinds of amino acids in the polypeptide chain, it was dissolved in very concentrated hydrochloric acid. In 6 molar, it is very strong hydrochloric acid and heated at 100 degrees centigrade for 24 hours. Basically, we are here hydrolyzing all the amide linkages, all the amide functional group, to convert it into the particular amino acid, the constituent amino acids, which after the condensation they form the peptide chain. So by treating it with a very strong acid, that's a 6 molar hydrochloric acid, and refluxing it at 100 degree centigrade, heating it at 100 degree centigrade, not refluxing, I will say here to be more appropriate, for the 24 hour, all the amide linkages gets hydrolyzed and it forms the carboxylic acid and the amine. In totality, I will write here, if you treat polypeptide, the 6 molar HCl at 100 degree centigrade, 24 hour, it generates amino acids, the constituent amino acids. The mixture of amino acid is passed through a amino acid analyzer. Now, the mixture of amino acid is passed through an amino acid analyzer. To identify the amino acid. Okay. Now, so in the primary structure, as I mentioned that we need to know that number and type of amino acids, as well as the disulfide bridges in the peptide chain. These are the requirements for primary structure, which we are evaluating by these two transformation. First one we did that, by treating the polypeptide chain with the thiomercaptol to reduce the disulfide bridge into the corresponding thiol. And then this thiol, since has kind of a property to go again oxidized to the disulfide, so again it is get reacted with the iodoacetic acid to form the corresponding acetic acid analog, so that it cannot re oxidize to disulfide. That way we can easily identify in the polypeptide chain by this transformation how many disulfide bridges are there. Another thing that how many amino acids are there, that to and what kind of amino acids are there, that can be easily learned by treating it with the 6 molar HCl and heat it at the 100 degree centigrade for 24 hour. One can get the all the amino acid in the mixture, and which can be easily identified through the amino acid analyzer, that what are the amino acids are there in that particular polypeptide chain. Now I will talk about the secondary structure. Secondary structure describes the repetitive conformation assumed by segment of assumed by segments of the backbone chain. Of a polypeptide or protein. In other words, secondary structure describes the segment of the backbone fold. Secondary structure describes how segments of the backbone, how segments of the backbone fold. Three factors determine the secondary structure of a segment of protein. Three factors, basically, three factors determine the secondary structure of a segment. First one, the regional planarity. Regional planarity about each peptide bond. Why is it so? As a result, of the partial double bond character of the amide bond. Which limits the possible conformations of the peptide chain. So, what are the three factors for the secondary structure that determine the, you know, structure of a segment of a protein? First one is the regional planarity about the each peptide bond. You know, how the every peptide bond is having, you know, planarity, and that occurs because of the double bond characteristic of the amide, you know, functional group. So, that basically restricts the, you know, conformational possibility of the peptide chain. So, that is one factor. Second is minimizing energy by maximizing the number of hydrogen bond. Maximizing the number of hydrogen bond. by maximizing the number of hydrogen bonds. Hydrogen bonds between peptide groups. That is hydrogen bonds between the carbonyl oxygen hydrogen bond between carbonyl oxygen of one amino acid and the amide hydrogen of another. So, how does it form? Let me through the structure I will represent here. So, as I mentioned, carbonyl of one, here I am putting the carbonyl group and amide of other. So, this is one strand and the other strand is carbonyl of one, amide chain with the amide of the other, amidic hydrogen of the other. These forms the hydrogen bond. Okay, so hydrogen form. Hydrogen bonding between peptide groups. Hydrogen bonding between peptide groups. Okay. Now, the third thing is the need of adequate separation. The need for adequate separation between the neighboring R group. Adequate separation between neighboring R groups. To avoid steric strain and repulsion of like charges. So, the need for adequate separation between neighboring R groups to avoid steric strain and repulsion of like charges. So, again I will like to repeat, the secondary structure describes the repetitive conformation assumed by segment of the backbone. In other words, that secondary structure describes how segments of the backbone fold, and to learn about it, we need to know the three factors, which determine the, structure of a segment of a protein. What are the three factors? First one is the regional planarity about each peptide bond, and that how does it happen? Because of the, double bond characteristic of the amide bond, which limits the possible conformation of the peptide chain. because, you know, if the double bond characteristic comes in because of the amide group, it does not allow that flexibility which can occur in its absence. So the conformational flexibility is lost in the peptide chain because of the double bond characteristic. Second is minimizing energy by maximizing the number of hydrogen bonds. As we know that this is the nature law, that every, you know, entity in this nature tries to remain in the least energy state, and to achieve that, you know, all kind of physical processes happens. And here basically the because of the hydrogen bonding, you know, it's because of the hydrogen bonding, it minimizes its energy, you know, and that can easily occur in the peptide chain, particularly in between the, you know, carbonyl group of, I mean, oxygen of the carbonyl group and the amidic NH, you know, with the, you know, hydrogen bonding can take place. So, carbonyl oxygen of one, you know, amidic group and the NH of the another amide group can engage in the hydrogen bond. That is very clear from this, you know, schematic presentation, how this carbonyl oxygen and the other amidic NH are engaged in the hydrogen bonding. Also, the need for adequate separation between neighboring R groups to about steric strain, so that, you know, it cannot, you know, have a steric. So, the folding takes place in a way so that the all the, you know, neighboring R groups remain far apart to have the minimal energy state and to avoid the esterics. So, these are the, you know, to avoid the esteric repulsion basically. So, also if charges are there, like, you know, as we know that, you know, amine can be in the ammonium form or the side chain can be in the ionized state. So, there also they need to remain far apart, so that they cannot have, you know, repulsion between each other. If the like charges are there, then they can have like repulsion. So, this is the third, you know, factor. Now, based on that, I will like to talk about the, you know, different type of secondary structure. First one is alpha helix. Alpha helix, one type of secondary structure is an alpha helix, this is one, and in alpha helix, the backbone of the polypeptide coils around the long axis of the protein molecule. So, in alpha helix, the backbone of the polypeptide coils around a long axis of the protein molecule. How does it happen? To represent it, let me draw the structure. So, this is the polypeptide chain. So, this is the coiling, and since it is double stranded, so basically the polypeptide chain is coiled around this axis, the long axis of the protein molecule. Now, because the amino acid have the L configuration, the alpha helix is right-handed. Amino acid have the L configuration, the alpha helix is a right-handed helix. Alpha helix is a right-handed helix. Right-handed helix. That is, it rotates in a clockwise direction. That is, it rotates in a clockwise direction. Clockwise direction as it spirals down. So, this is the clockwise. So, basically it is coming. So, this is the clockwise. As it, you can see here, like as it spirals down. Each turn of the helix contain 3.6 amino acid. This each turn of the helix contains 3.6 amino acid, contains 3.6 amino acids, and the repeat distance of the helix is 5.4 angstrom. You can see here, the repeat distance of the helix is 5.4 angstrom. 5.4 angstrom, and each turn of the helix contain 3.6 amino acid exactly, and basically it has the hydrogen bond, as I told that, you know, in the secondary structure, basically 4 amino acid away. This hydrogen bonding is taking place 4 amino acids away. And the repeat distance of the helix. So, each turn of the helix contains 3.6 amino acids, and the repeat distance of the helix repeat distance of the helix is 5.4 angstrom. This is important information basically. Now, let us talk about, so this is one alpha helix is the one secondary structure, and the second one is beta pleated sheet. The second type of secondary structure is beta pleated sheet. How does it look like? In the beta pleated sheet, I will make the pictorial representation through which you will understand. So, in the beta pleated sheet, two sheets are anti-parallel. So, let me draw first anti-parallel, as I told you. So, that is why I am, you know, making this opposite orientation of these two sheets. And basically These are the two seats. Just I am with the solid lines, I am representing that the two seats are there, which are folded in anti-parallel to each other. So this is a anti-parallel beta pleated seat. And then I will draw here the other. So in another secondary structure, the polypeptide chains are parallel. Parallel. So this is the parallel beta pleated seat. So parallel beta pleated seat. Here the hydrogen bonding in a beta pleated seat occurs between neighboring peptide chains. These are the two peptide chains. So basically this is the, you know, in between the hydrogen bonding is taking place. Similarly, this is the anti-parallel, and in the case of parallel also, I can represent here. So the hydrogen bonding in a beta pleated seat occurs between neighboring peptide chain. Between neighboring peptide chains. Between neighboring peptide chains. A beta pleated seat is almost fully extended and the average 2 amino acid repeat distance is 7 angstrom. Average 2 amino acids repeat distance is 7 angstrom. The part of the backbone is structure of a protein background that exists in a pleated seat the part of the backbone structure. Backbone structure of a protein background that exists in a pleated seat is seat is indicated by a flat arrow pointing so this is I'm talking about the flat arrow pointing in the end to C direction. Flat arrow pointing in the end to C direction. Again, I will repeat here, in the beta pleated seat, the hydrogen bonding in a beta pleated seat between the neighboring peptide chains occurs, that I have shown here in these two, in one case it is anti-parallel, another case the, parallel. So, a beta pleated seat is almost fully extended, the average 2 amino acid repeat distance is 7 angstrom, and the part of the backbone structure of a protein background that exists in a beta pleated seat is indicated by a flat arrow, that is the flat arrow pointing in the end to C direction. For example, silk contains a large proportion of relatively small amino acids. Relatively small amino acid. And therefore, has large segment of beta pleated seat. Therefore, has large segments of beta pleated seat. Segment of beta pleated seat. The number of side-by-side strand in a beta pleated seed ranges from 2 to 15 in a globular protein. Side-by-side strand, I'm particularly this talking about this side-by-side strand. The number of side-by-side strands in a beta pleated seed ranges from 2 to 15 in a globular protein. The average strand in a beta pleated seed section contains 6 amino acids. Average strand in a beta pleated seed section seat section contains 6 amino acids. So, these are the another wool and fibrous portion of the muscle have secondary structure fibrous protein of muscle, wool and fibrous protein of muscle have secondary structure that are almost all alpha helix. Alpha helix. Beta pleated seeds are occurred in the silk and spider way. Are occurred in silk and spider waves. We are seeing spider wave in our houses also, and you know, spider wave, and it cannot be stressed. Cannot be stressed. So, I will stop here, today lecture, and I will again continue with the structure of protein. Particularly the secondary structure in the next class. Thank you very much.